creation.
Sabbath, everyone. So I encourage everyone to please get your Bible and open it in the book of Romans, chapter 8, verses 15 to 17. Romans, chapter 8, verses 15 to 17. It says, "For ye have not received the spirit of bondage again to fear, but ye have received the spirit of adoption, whereby we cry, Abba, Father. The Spirit itself beareth witness with our spirit that we are the children of God. 17, and if children, then heirs, heirs of God, and joint heirs with Christ, if so be that we suffer with him, that we may be also glorified together."
Let us kneel for the hymn of preparation.
Us together, Lord, to worship you and remember how great you are, being our Creator. Father, We humbly come to thy presence, Lord, lifting our praises and thanksgiving, Father. We thank you that you love us. We thank you that you care for us, that throughout the week, you've given us the strength, you've given us the faith, you've given us, Lord, the wisdom that we may overcome every temptation. Father, right this moment, thank you for your desire to be with us. Yet our sins pushes you away, Father. So please, Lord, purify our hearts and minds and let your Holy Spirit be enthroned, that our meditations, our actions, Father, our words, everything about us will be sacred, that we may keep your Sabbath holy. And thank you, Father, for calling us to be heirs of your kingdom, though unworthy we are. We pray, Lord, that as you are about to give us a special message, a message that will inspire us more to serve you, please bless Brother Ravel. Help him have the right words from the Holy Spirit. Help him have the wisdom that is from you. Help him have the emotion, the gestures, Father. Help him have the motive of his heart to only be an instrument of blessing God's people. Father, thank you so much that we should never doubt, for everything was already answered, for we pray and claim it in the powerful and holy name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.
Thank you. Can you imagine a prospective parent saying, "We'd like to adopt Johnny, but first, we want to ask a few things. Does Johnny have a house to live in? Does Johnny have money for tuition? Or does he have a school ride every morning and afternoon? Or does he have clothes? Does Johnny know how to prepare meals for himself or men clothes?" Well, of course, no agency could stand with such talk, right? Its representative most probably would lift their hand saying, wait a minute. You don't understand. You adopted Johnny not because of what he has, but because of what he needs. He needs a home. My friends, the same is true with God. God adopted us not because of what we have. He adopted us, He gave us His name, not because of what we can do, like the passion that we have for ministry, like this vigor, like our wit, our wallet. Adoption is something we receive, not something we earn. God welcomed us in His family, to His house, because the owner adopted us, right? God adopted us. God sought us. God found us. God signed the entitlement by His blood. And that is what we're going to talk about this morning. We will know how God has given us indeed the entitlement to be called as sons and daughters of God. But of course, before anything else, I would like to invite you to bow with me as we come in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ in prayer. Heavenly Father, I recognize that I'm the least amongst us here. But I ask for the Holy Spirit to purge my soul and filter it so that nothing will be left. Then Jesus Christ will be filled in me. And even so with each one of us here in this house of yours. May we be able to recognize and learn then how to appreciate when you have called us as your sons and daughters. May this experience, may this worship help us never be the same again. We pray all these things in Jesus' name, and we trust that you will help us, that this will be our experience. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. God originally planned man to be called as His children. When He created Adam and Eve, God meant them to be His children. So therefore, they could be called as children of God. But unfortunately, suddenly, there is something that happened. Sin entered Eden, and that made them disqualified to be called as children of God. What do we call them now? They are called as children of the enemy. What does that mean, Brother Ovel? It means that when the enemy has conquered them, it led each generation with all the propensities to sin. And it made us indeed children or slaves of sin. Who among you here are children of the enemy? Of course, we don't want to be called such. But some time of our life, we have been. And at times, we are. This morning, we will study how God has brought us back to the entitlement to be called as His sons and daughters. The title of the message this morning is Status Upgrade. From Perception to Reality. Why from perception to reality? We would know later on that we just perceive that we are sons and daughters, well, in fact, it is not the reality. We are not living in its reality. We will learn later on, and we will go deeper how God has brought us back to that status as sons and daughters of God. So when sin entered, there you go. You know the story. They came to a point that they went to this blame game. The other point to the other, and then it ended up that it all pointed out to whom? To God. The serpent you have created. So eventually it is pointing the finger to God. But you know what the good news is? While they are shaking, while they are trembling, while they are crumbling, God has announced the promise in Genesis 3:15. Genesis 3:15 has given us the promise that I will what? Saying to the serpent, I will what? Put enmity between you and the woman, and between your seed and her seed. He shall bruise your head, and you shall bruise his heel. To go directly, who is this seed that we are talking about here? You will find that in Galatians 3, verse 16, it's just near Genesis 3:15 and Galatians 3:16. I hope that you will not forget that. That the seed that the Bible is talking about is no other than Jesus Christ. Now unto Abraham and his seed were the promises made. He does not say, and two seeds, right? As of many, but as of one. And to your seed, who is Christ. So who will be the seed that will crush the head of the serpent? It is Jesus Christ. So of course, if you are the devil and you have heard that pronouncement, what would you do? Since that time, he prevented what? The seed to come. He made all his way so that this seed could not come. And you know what are the strategies of the devil? There are only two things. There are only two ways. It's either killing or mingling. What does it mean by killing and mingling? Of course, by killing, you kill directly the person. And it vanishes away. Next one, mingling. By mingling, he will what? He will intermingle us with marriages, with people, and then it will confuse our identity. That is why. And bear with me this moment. I need to have a recap of the week of prayer so that we will see how God has brought us back to the entitlement to be called as sons and daughters of God. Because the week of prayer is not just something about of values, of these things, but there is something behind it. There's even, what do you call this one? An underground story that moves towards the history that brings us back to be called as his heirs. Let us talk about Adam. Going back last Monday, we have talked about the importance of the oneness of the family, right? We have learned that it is very important, though we may be distant by presence or by physical, but it needs still to be one by heart, by mind. Oneness is very important in the family. But you know what? The devil really wanted to destroy family. No wonder our families are getting these terrible problems because he doesn't want us to what? To prosper and to be called as children of God. That's why he interrupted this couple. And we have learned a while ago that sin entered. But I would like you to notice something. The promise in Genesis 3:15 that there will be a seed. So when Cain was born, Satan thought, this might be the seed. This might be the seed that will crush me. What are the strategies of the devil? Killing and mingling. So if he's only one, who will kill Cain? None. Could it be his father? Could it be his mother? No. But you know what? Abel came later. And Satan also thought, oh, I could have one to kill the seed. And you know the story, right? You know the story that Cain, what? Killed Abel. Because Satan, what? Satan knows that this seed might be the one that will crush his head. So he uses Satan, and you will find that in 1 John 3:12, that it is the devil or it is the evil within that worked through Cain to kill Abel. And then, does Adam and Eve have a seed then? No. But you know what? The promise in Genesis 4:25. Open your Bibles with me to Genesis 4:25, and you would notice that the Lord is in control. The Lord is still in control. It says, I will not place it in the presentation so that we will go to the Word of God. Genesis 4:25, it says here, and Adam knew his wife again, and she bare a son, and called his name Seth. Who is the seed? Seth. For God said, she hath appointed me another what? Seed instead of Abel, whom Cain slew. So it's through the line of Seth that what? That comes the seed. And it went through on to Noah and then Abraham. And there you will find, on the time of Abraham, God has given the promise that they will be a blessing, according to Genesis 12, verses 1 to 3. Now, it led us to the next story, that from Abraham came this Isaac, right? You remember the story last, okay? We have been taught about the principles of courtship. Who among you here could relate very well? And I believe many of us might think that we are not in the courtship, but acting as in the courtship, and then we confuse ourselves. Friends lang naman kami. You know why? The devil would like to destroy the principles of courtship because he knows that will really bring the what? The right principles of being an heir of God. So that's why he wanted to mingle it, confuse it, so that we will lose our identity. So we've learned courtship, the principles of courtship in the story of Isaac. But don't you know, it is not just about that. Behind that is a story that God needs to preserve another seed from Isaac. And that is through whom? Jacob, which then called us Israel. And then we have learned that. And then it went on to the next character, which is no other than Joseph. Joseph is a very potential person, a very potential youth. It is talking to us how we should keep our identity and also the integrity that God has purposed with each one of us. But the problem is Jacob played a different role. He played what? Favoritism. And all throughout the life of Joseph, he has kept the integrity. He has kept the integrity of what it is indeed to be as heirs of God, to be children of God. And then it went on. Through Joseph, you would notice the importance of Joseph in the story of our week of prayer heirs is something so important in the line to preserve the seed. You know why? Because there came a moment that Israel is facing starvation. How many years is that? The Bible has mentioned it's only 2 at first, but there's another 5, so it's how many? 7 and all. Why do you think that there is a starvation to Israel that time? Because the devil knows that what? The seed will come from where? From Israel. from Israel, from the tribe of Israel. He knows that the seed will come there. But thanks be to God, in the life of Joseph, according to Genesis 45, verses 5 to 7, it says here, Joseph really knows God's purpose in his life. So are we, my dear friends, to know God's purpose in our lives. It says in Genesis 45, verses 5 to 7. It says here, "Now therefore, be not grieved nor angry with yourselves," talking about his brothers, "that ye sold me hither," or here. "For God did send me for you to what? Preserve life. For these 2 years had the famine been in the land, and yet there are 5 years in the which there shall neither be earing nor harvest. And God sent me before you to preserve you a what? Posterity in the earth." Are you seeing the hands of God working here? Yet the devil wanted to interrupt. He wanted to distract. And then it went on to another story, which we have learned on Tuesday afternoon. And that is no other than Moses. We have learned their mother's role, that the foundations of a child comes from a mother. And we have learned at some of the writings of the pen of inspiration that through the younger years, the influence of the mother is very, very important. We have learned there that 2 to 4 years old are what? The times that the mind is going to what? Mature up to how many percent? 90%. Do you remember that? Okay, we have learned that. But you know why? Why is it very important to preserve Moses in that time? Because what? Through him will be the exodus of Israel. And through Israel is what? Will come the seed that has been promised to Genesis from Genesis 3:15. Well, just follow with me, because later on I will explain to you and wrap it up into one sense and one single point that made us indeed as sons and daughters of God. Moses, and you would notice that in the time of Moses while leading Israel, what had happened? They have been in bondage for how many years? Yes, we have known that. And who is the main, what do you call this one? The main enemy that the devil used? Pharaoh. Do you think that Pharaoh really wanted that? I don't think so. And you will find in the Bible that God hardened his heart. But that doesn't really mean that he's the one who purposed it to be hardened. The same way with us, when we have been in a constant rejection of God's voice, it hardens our heart. But you know what? There is something even deeper and something even beyond what we could see from the life of Pharaoh. And you would notice that. Who among you here knows the meaning of the name of Pharaoh? It might be your first time to know this, but you will find that in Ezekiel 29, verse 3. Open your Bibles in Ezekiel 29, verse 3, and you will find indeed that in the lens of the promise of Genesis 3:15, you will find indeed the battle, the controversy that is going on, because there will be a seed that will bring us back to the what? To be called the sons and daughters of God. Ezekiel 29, verse 3. Now, it goes like this from the King James Version. "Speak and say, thus saith the Lord God, behold, I am against thee, Pharaoh, king of Egypt, the great" what? Isn't that a coincidence? That Pharaoh is called the great dragon? And who is the dragon representing? The old serpent, according to Revelation 12, verse 9. Is it a coincidence? There is a great battle here. The devil would like to, what? To own us as his children. But God wants us to bring us back to Him as His children. But praise be to God, these great heroes of faith indeed receive the what? The entitlement as sons and daughters of God because of their faith. But it's not yet enough until the sign will be given to the entitlement. Now it goes on to the next one. Through whom? David. Okay, let's go first with David. We have talked about Absalom, but throughout those days, Wednesday, we have learned about David, his role to Absalom and also to Solomon. Now, you would notice we have learned from Wednesday our what? Our responsibility to submit ourselves, not just to parents, but even to authorities. You will know that the life of Absalom has been in rebellion against his father. But David loves him so much. Even to the time of his death, he still look for him. But what does that mean? I would like to point there, my dear friends, my dear brothers and sisters. While we are here in the university, not just with our university, but even wherever we may go, always remember that God has appointed these people to lead us. And we should remember that we are submitting ourselves not just to them, but even to the great authority that comes from God. And you know what is even more special with that? I thank God that God has indeed designed them to be like David, who will love us so much. Amen? Isn't that amazing that we have our faculties, we have our administrators who have been our parents that has loved us. We just thought that they are what? They are doing these things against us. No, no, no. These are all for our good. The problem is we still have that inclination towards being a children of the enemy. I will explain that later. And then it goes to the life of Solomon. And through the line of Solomon will come also the seed. Isn't this a coincidence that we have chosen these characters? No. I believe God has really meant something here for each one of us so that when we move out from this place, we will have the reality of being called as sons and daughters of God. Now we have learned from the life of Solomon that there are some trends from his father that he was able to inherit. Have you noticed that from Wednesday afternoon? We have learned that there are many things in our family background. I have learned a while ago that leadership, in order for us to be successful in leadership, we need to know first our family background. So the same way with every details of our life, we need to go first understand our family background, because there might be trends that in a wrong path that we still continue. Have you noticed that? Esther has emphasized that there are three problems, weaknesses of David, the same way that has been inherited by Solomon. And that is no other than pride, custom, and women. What it is trying to say for each one of us, as heirs of God, there have been inclination towards sins that needs to be broken, that we could be brought back to be called as sons and daughters of God. And then it went on to the life of who? Who's the next character? Daniel. They have kept the integrity. And we thank God that God has given that as an example for us to choose very well our right friends, not just in the choosing of right friends, but being the right friend. We have learned that in that morning, the importance to stand in integrity together with our friends is very much important. And then we have learned in the afternoon, in the life of Esther. You know what? This is amazing. Because in the life of Esther comes an account that will end the genealogy from the Old Testament. And then what comes next? It's in Matthew. But in the life of Esther, we have learned here that she has been an orphan, right? Some of us may feel to be an orphan, but you know what? The Bible has told us that He will never leave us orphan. He will always be with us. And we have learned there the importance of Mordecai in her life. What it is emphasizing for each one of us is that the importance of every mentors for our university life. We thought that we already can make it and do it. That is why the university has programmed something that will implement what? Mentorship for each one of us. Because that will build our identity as heirs of God. And then it went on to Friday morning. From the life of Timothy, we have learned that the home, the core values of the home, should shape our mission. It should not be the mission that would shape our home. We just go back then, okay, I've been good in the mission, and then go back. I will go back to my family. But the problem is this, we forget that it is in the opposite way. We need to establish first ourselves in the family so that we could understand, though young we may be, our mission for God. And then the true adoption was emphasized last night, from being useless to useful. And then it went on, my dear friends. And then it went on. You would notice, indeed, that from this generation to generation, the devil would like to interrupt the coming of the seed. Because he knows that we will be brought back to the entitlement as sons and daughters of God. But there are people who have been called, indeed, because of their faith. And those are the great heroes of faith. I would like you to notice this quotation from the Desire of Ages. The Desire of Ages says, "The Savior's coming was foretold in Eden. When Adam and Eve first heard the promise, they looked for its speedy fulfillment. They joyfully welcomed their firstborn, hoping that he might be the deliverer. But the fulfillment of the promise what? Tarried from generation to generation to generation. Those who were first received it died without the sight of seeing the seed. From the days of Enoch, the promise was repeated through the patriarchs and prophets, keeping alive the hope of his appearing, and yet he came not. What would God do then? He's still not coming. The prophecy of Daniel revealed the time of his Advent, but not all rightly interpreted the message. Century after century passed away, the voices of the prophets ceased. The hand of the oppressor was heavy upon Israel, and many were ready to exclaim, 'The days are prolonged, and every vision faileth.'" But I would like you to notice this. This is very comforting. "But like the stars in the vast circuit of their appointed path, God's purposes know no haste and no delay." Amen? You might be going through your life with something that you don't understand, you could not understand, but this is what I would like to tell you, my dear friends, my dear brothers and sisters, my dear co-heirs with God. God's purpose, no delay, and what? And haste. He will work all things according to His purpose. That is no wonder the song goes, that though the wrong seem of so strong, God is the ruler yet. And then it goes, "This is my Father's world. Why should my heart be sad? The Lord is King. Let the heavens ring, God reigns, let the earth be glad." Why should we be glad? Because we know that this is our Father's world. We know that the Father is in control of everything. From generation to generation, God wants us to understand the principle or that intimacy in trusting upon our Heavenly Father. Our Heavenly Father. Now, when did Jesus come? When did Jesus come? Open your Bibles to Galatians chapter 3. And this is our main study this morning. Galatians 3, and it starts from verse 26. Galatians 3, verse 26, and we'll go further, and we'll continue. It says, "For ye are all what? The children of God by faith in Jesus Christ. For as many of you as have been baptized into Christ have put on Christ. There is neither Jew nor Greek, there is neither bond nor free, there is neither male nor female, for ye are all one in Jesus Christ. And if ye be Christ," this is the promise, "then are ye Abraham's what? Seeds and heirs according to the promise." Now, little by little, we will see how we become called as sons and daughters of God, how we have been retained to the entitlement as sons and daughters of God. Now, you would notice here that it is important to understand the meaning of sonship or being called as his children. But Paul, in this letter, mentioned different metaphors with regards to slavery and then freedom and then sons and then adoption. You have seen that. But I would like to point here that there is something that is very important for us to understand. We have been called as children of the enemy and we have been enslaved by it. The natural propensities have been there. That is why there are things that you don't want to do, but you do. There are things that you would like to do, but you do not do, as Paul has mentioned as well. But listen to this. You would notice the importance to understand that from being slave, God has called us to be sons and adopted each one of us. Listen carefully how it goes on. Verse 1 of chapter 4. "Now I say that the heir, as long as he is a child, different nothing from a servant," or he is not different from a servant, "though he be Lord of all, but is under tutors and governors until the time appointed of the Father." Verse 3. "Even so we, when we were children, were in bondage under the elements of the world." What is trying to point here, Paul is trying to tell us that this enslavement has still been in our nature. And being slave from the first century has a very, very challenging experience, my dear friends. You know why? The master have many rights for his servant. And not even to mention, there are terrible things that he could do for the servant because he paid for it. But there are also these servants who are highly paid. They become secretaries, they become what? Next to the master. But I would like you to notice something here. The mentality of a servant is this. They would like only to do things under obligation because this is what their responsibility is. Am I communicating something here? Okay, I would like you to notice that Paul would like us to understand first that many of us are still in the mentality of a slave. What does that mean? It means that many of us are connected only to our master under obligation, under burden. So, we will only work according to what they command. Right? Is it also reflecting with our families? Do we also have this mentality as a slave? You know what? We have this mentality of a slave. When your father asks you a favor, please, anak, can you wash the dishes? Si daddy naman eh, inutusan ako eh. Nanunood pa nga ako eh. Naglalaro pa nga kami. We're still playing here. We're still watching movie here, TV here. And then we will work as if, ah, God, your father, brother, help me here. Let's make this quick so that we can go back to our, to watching, to our game. We work accordingly to burden and obligation. That is a mentality of a slave. Let me shift once again. Let me go back once again to that perspective in the first century. There are many slaves wanted to be freed, right? But you know, my dear friends, not because you wanted to be free, you could already become what? A son. You will just be free. You can do anything that you would like to do, but you don't have the privilege as if to a son. Many of us wanted to go out from this mentality. I would like to go out from slavery. We would like to be free. We would like to be free from this imprisonment. Am I speaking something here, my dear friends? That is the mentality of a slave. And the same way with us, we also have this mentality of a slave. Although we could recognize that God is our Father, yet we work things as a slave, under obligation, under burden, under bitterness, under working only under the job description that we have. But beyond job description, we don't work anymore because this is a mentality of a slave. Isn't it happening also here? Yes. Because as an heir of God, we need to look to the propensity, to the tendency that we go back to that mentality, to that nature as a slave. We are enslaved to sin. Some of us here are struggling with something, being enslaved by it, thinking that they could not be freed from it. They could not overcome it. Yes, God understands that. Some of us are struggling at some point that, it's already for 2 years that I was not able to drink. Thank God. But there's still this struggle. Because the slave man is still there. And then we will say, Lord, hindi naman may iwasan eh. We cannot get rid of it. But the problem indeed is because we still have the mentality of a slave. Let me talk to each one of us personally now, in different levels. I would like to say this, not to step on someone's shoe, but I would like to say this with sincerity and love for us to get away from the mentality of being a slave. You know what? Many of us, let me go first with the students. Many of us would like to accomplish our career. We would like to accomplish our career as if an obligation, as if a burden from our parents. And then we will do this just to the expectation of the parents, right? But you know what? Why we are having that mentality, it's because the mentality of a slave is still there. Are you seeing the point here now? The mentality of a slave is still being there and not doing these things out of our intimate relationship from our parents. Now, working students, Some of us work only according to job description, according to the time limit that the supervisor gave us, right? It's only from 7:30 to 12 o'clock. No work beyond that. But the problem is, we don't even work within the course of time, the period that is given us. And then when the supervisor will say, can you please do this? Can you please do this? We are burdened. We are in bitterness thinking that this is a tough obligation. That is still a mentality of a slave. Permit me to say this. How about to our dear faculties and staff? I would like to talk to you as your son. Is there also time in our life that you work with the obligation of doing things only according to your job description? And beyond the job description, you would not like to work. I would like to tell this sincerely, that is still in the mentality of a slave. And for everybody, for everyone else here, we are still in that bondage. In that bondage. So how could we free then? How could we be freed from this burden, from this obligation, from this hardness, from this bitterness? As children of the enemy, we are inclined to do this. But I thank God, it did not stop there. The verse did not stop there. It says in verse 4, but when the fullness of the time was come, God sent forth His Son, made of a woman, made under the law. It's been by that time that we have been called as sons and daughters of God. First one, I would like you to notice, according to this quotation from Testimonies, Volume 9, it says, it was at infinite cost that provision was made whereby the human, what? Family might be restored to sonship with God. The promise of a what? Of a deliverer from where? Genesis 3:15, and God said to the serpent, and between what? Thy seed and our seed, it shall bruise thy head, and it shall bruise thy heel. And it continues, all that had been lost by yielding to Satan could be regained through Christ. Amen? He is the only one who could redeem us back to the sonship that we have with God. He could entangle us. He could take us away from that entanglement, from that enslavement, from that perception, from that mentality of a slave. All that had been lost, the Son of God was given to redeem the race at infinite suffering, the sinless for the sinful. The price was paid that was to redeem the human family from the power of the destroyer and restore them again into the image of God. Those who accept the salvation brought to them in Christ will humble themselves before God as His little children. You would see the transition that it says here, to redeem them. When we become indeed as children of God, we will be humble, say, Lord, thank you so much that from this bondage, I've been enslaved by being a children of the enemy. That's why I'm doing this against you. But Jesus Christ, in the fullness of time, what? Broke it all for us and even signed the entitlement for us with His blood. With His blood. And you would notice the first point I would like to leave with you this morning. For us, as being sons and daughters of God, let us always remember letter S, the first point. The sending of Jesus Christ. That is according to Galatians 4, verse 4. This is signed by His blood. The way indeed to home is only by the cross. It's only by the cross when He has been crucified. You know what? The mentality of the Jews that time. The mentality of the Jews that time is this. When you are Abraham's seed, you are automatically as children of God. But they are still working to the mentality of a slave. That is why I called it perception, not reality. Is it connecting to each one of us? We recognize God as our Father, yet we are still acting as if what? Slave. I thank God that in the fullness of time, He has what? He has wrapped up everything that we have talked about this week of prayer. And it says here that from the first night, from the first day, Jesus risked to be separate from the heavenly home, right? For us to be brought back to that heavenly home. On the second session, Jesus has been our suitor. The third session, Jesus has not played favoritism, but He's seen the potential from each one of us and empowered it for the work of God and for the glory of God. The fourth session, Jesus survived the wilderness for how many days? 40 days. How many years for Moses? 40 years, so that He could be the Savior of Israel. Number five, Jesus submitted Himself to the Father. And another one, Jesus, the sixth session, Jesus broke the wrong trends of life and realigned it so that we will be brought back as called as children of God. The seventh session, we have learned from His friend, Jesus Christ is our true friend. He is our best friend. He will stand for us. He will stand with us whatever trial we may face. He will stand with us. He will stand for us. On the next session, we have learned from Mordecai and Esther that Jesus Christ is our mentor. He is our master teacher. The ninth session, Jesus was fully aware of His mission, though He is young, so that we also should know our mission and follow Christ. And last night, Jesus made Himself of no reputation, useless to useful, of no reputation, that we will be exalted as He has been exalted. Isn't that a good news? Jesus came in the fullness of time so that we will be brought back as a children of God, not as a slave, not as to the mentality of slaves. I thank God. I thank God for sending Jesus Christ. And you know what? The second point is this. Not just that He sent His Son, but we have been owned by His Father. Amen? It says here, to redeem them that were under the law, that we might receive the adoptions of sons. Galatians is very particular with adoption. That's why, though we are enslaved with this, my son, my daughter, why are you still doing that? I would like you to be my son. I would like to get out from that enslavement. Come to me. Come to me, I am your Father. You have been owned by the Father. And then it continues to say, you would notice this. It would be enough indeed that Jesus would just cleanse us. But He did more. He gave us His name. It would be enough for Jesus Christ just to free us from sin. But He did more. He signed our entitlement through His blood by the what? Sacrifice at the cross of Calvary. You know, every Jew, though they are thinking that they are automatically called as children of God, it is not sufficient until the crucifixion of Jesus Christ. That is the sign of that entitlement, so that for each one of us, we need to go by faith and accept that crucifixion, the sacrifice of Christ in the cross of Calvary. And then it continued, verse 6, and because ye are sons, I thank God for the next one. He has sent the Holy Spirit. He has sent the Spirit of His Son into your hearts. We're crying what? Abba, Father. Wherefore thou art no more a servant, but a son. And if a son, then an heir of God through Christ. You know what? What this is trying to tell us is this. Being a son is not burdened to do things under obligation from the Father. But rather, he will do things because he is intimate with the Father. He wanted to do things because he loves the Father. He wanted to do things because he is in a deep relationship with the Father. So the thinking is not, the thinking is this, what else can I do for my Father? Because he has done much for me. What else can I do for my Father? That is why no wonder that in 1 John 3:1, behold what manner of love the Father has given unto us. Behold what manner of love the Father has given unto us. Can you sing the next one? That should be called the sons of God. That lift him up, says that through the nurturance, the third point is the nurturing of the Holy Spirit. The nurturance of the Holy Spirit. And now I would like you to read this with me. It says here in Lift Him Up, ye have received the Spirit of adoption, whereby we cry, Abba, Father. With the beloved John first, I call upon you to behold what manner of love the Father has bestowed upon us, that we should be called the what? The sons of God. What love, what matchless love, that sinners and aliens are we, as we are, we may be brought back to God and adopted into His family. We may address Him by the endearing name, our Father, which is a sign of our affection for Him. And a pledge of His tender regard and relationship to us. And the Son of God, beholding the heirs of grace, is not ashamed to call us what? Brother, and you know what? The good news, when we have been nurtured by the Holy Spirit and when we have been owned by the Father, what will happen is this. Jesus Christ will present us to the Father, and then He will say to the Father, Father, I have a new brother. I have a new sister. Okay, who's that? It's Rovell. Oh, he is my son too. Amen? When you have been presented by Jesus Christ, you become the sons of God. You become the daughters of God. And then going back to Romans 8, it says, this is our key text. You have read that from 15 to 17, but I would like to end this by the next verse. Verse 17, and if children, then heirs. Heirs of God and joint heirs with God, with Christ, if so be that we suffer with Him, that we may be what? Be glorified together. What are the sufferings that you are going through, my friends? Because the mentality of a slave will just think that they are being suffering. But a son, though it may be hard that the Father has commanded something because of his intimate relationship with the Father, he will do it wholeheartedly. You know, we have learned from this week, it is not actually just from the family. It is not just actually from the university. And then going beyond, it is more of our relationship directly to the Heavenly Father. That is the main issue. We have problems in the family. We have problems in the university. We have problems beyond in our work. It's because we don't recognize God indeed as our Father. We don't have the reality. We don't act in the reality of being His son. What else would you ask? God has made us heirs of God. So whatever suffering you may have, I invite you to go to the next verse. I thank God. For I reckon that the sufferings of this present time are not worthy to be compared with the glory which shall be revealed in us. And that time will come when Jesus comes on the second time. We will be inheritors at last. That time we will be indeed brought back to the image of God according to 1 John 3:2. And then indeed He will bring us back to Him as His children forever and ever. There's these brothers, two brothers, Johnny and June. They have this relationship with the father, but unfortunately, Johnny abused it. At some point, he said to the father, "Father, can I have my riches?" Because of the grace of the father, because of the love of the father, he gave it to Johnny. But the problem is, Johnny squandered the riches until he came to the lowest point of his life. And then even to the point of eating the food of the pigs. Are you familiar with the story? And he came to his senses, right? He came to his senses and then he made this line. You know what is the line of the Johnny? The line of Johnny is still in the mentality of a servant. "Father, just do this for me and just give me this privilege and I will do this for you. As an obligation, as a burden." So when he went back to his senses, he goes back to his kingdom, to his palace, to the palace. And not knowingly, his father is waiting for him day by day. You know what's the reason? The culture then, when you go out from the palace, from your home, and then you have taken your riches, you could be sued to killed. That is no wonder he will be what? Be looking forward for the coming back of the son. And so no wonder when the son went back, who is the first one who initiated the what? The connection. It is the father who rushed to the, "This is my son, that is my son." He rushed to the son and then embraced him. While Johnny is still making his what? His words. He was embraced by the father and even kissed, though it might smell different. But the love made him as what? A sweet aroma. And then they had a party, right? They had a party. They have been enjoying. They have been enjoying. They what? They killed the calf. And then the servant, Jerry, was able to see June coming. "What's this party going on?" Jerry said, "Your brother Johnny, your brother Johnny's back. Come and join us." "Okay. Johnny's back? Really? Okay, I'll just follow." Then he went inside. Seeing the party going on, they're happy. June saw his father, but he could not reach it because of his what? Of what he feels, of what has happened. He called Jerry. "Jerry!" Of course, with the noise, he could barely hear June. "Jerry!" "Oh, yes, June. Please tell my father." What shall I tell your father?" "Tell him I'm mad." "Ah, yes, I will tell him you're glad, yes." Then he went to the father. "Sir, June is here and he's very glad." And then the father brought Johnny to June. "June, here comes your brother. He is your brother. He's been dead and now alive. Aren't you happy that he's here? Aren't you happy that he's here? You know, June said, Father, I've been with you for all these years. Yet you have not killed even a goat for me. You have not even given me a party. You know what is in the thinking of June? He still have the mentality of a slave. And then he said to the father, Father, I've worked for you all my life and you have not done this for me. You know, the father said, of course, he's in pain. And then he asked June, you mean all this time you are serving me as a servant? You are not my servant. You are my son. And you have all the privilege of the kingdom. You are my son. You are not my servant. You are my son. Matthew 25:34 says, "Then the king will say to those to his right, 'Come here, you beloved. Come here, you beloved, you people whom my Father has blessed. Claim your inheritance, the kingdom prepared for you from the beginning of creation.'" Jesus has been promised for us to be brought back in the children of God. Every head's bowed, every eyes closed at this moment. Please bow your heads. Please close your eyes. And I need you to talk to your God. Talk to Him as your Father. There might be times in your life, indeed, that you are doing things not because as a son and a daughter of God, but you are still having the mentality of a slave. At this moment of time, I would like to call. First, I would like to call first those people, if you are that person who is already a son of God, yes, you still have the mentality of a slave. You work only by your job description, by your obligation, but not going because you have an intimate relationship with the Father. At this moment, I ask you to please come here in front. We will be giving you a special prayer. And if you have realized indeed that you are this son who are still in the mentality of a slave, I need you to come here in front and we will give you a special prayer. While others are still talking to God, if you recognize my brother that you are that person, my sister, if you are that person, you can come while I am still talking here. You can come while others are still praying at this moment. Some of you really need to change allegiance from slave to sons. You are no longer slaves, but sons because of Jesus Christ. And even more, I would like to talk to you, my dear brothers and sisters, who are already Adventists. You already been Adventists for many years, but you have been working, have been talking and walking your life as if you are a slave, thinking that all this life that you are having is just an obligation because you are an Adventist. And so at times you fail in your relationship with the Father. And so it did not grow, it did not grow, it could not grow. If you are that Adventist, I call you to change your allegiance right now from slave to sonship. And if you are that person, I ask you also to please come here in front. We will be giving you a special prayer. And the Father of the University will pray for us. If you are that Adventist who still think that you are Adventist, but it's only by perception, not by reality. You live as if your Father will not come again. If you are that, my brother, my sister, I invite you here in front. I invite you here in front. And the third call I would like to ask. Maybe some of you here are being slaves by sin. And you have recognized that you could not escape, be freed from it. I tell you, my brother, I tell you, my sister, it is only your Father who could help you. It's only Jesus who could help you. And if you are that person, you have recognized that you have gone away like the son, like Johnny, and you have squandered your sonship, I ask you also to please come here in front. Who among you here have squandered their sonship from God? You work on your own pleasure. You went to your own will. Your Father is calling you at this moment. It is not me who are calling you. Maybe God is really calling you right now to renew your covenant with Him as His son, as His daughter. God bless you. God bless you. And at this point of time, please continue pray in your seats. While I ask our dear Father here, our University Father, to give us the special prayer. You can continually talk to God and not abandon anymore your sonship, but claim it as yours because you are a son of God, and work your life, live your life with that intimate relation because you have the privilege to be called the sons and daughters of God. You may bow your heads and continue to talk to God as our University Father will pray for each one of us.
Our Father, what can we say? Your love is so powerful, so overwhelming. And yet, O Lord, we realize that at many times in our lives, despite your love, despite your goodness, many times we thought you were our enemy. Our enemy who is out to go after us, out with so many rules, so many demands, so many burdens placed upon us, that as much as possible we want to run away from you because you're our enemy. Oh Lord, please forgive us. For the times we thought that you were a threat to our happiness, you were a threat to our future. Oh Lord, please forgive us. For some of us, we have already passed that stage. We have already entered your household. We have come home. And yet, O Lord, we realize now that all through the years that we were home, we did not behave much more, think like we were your son, we are your daughter. We acted, we thought like a slave. Oh Lord, the years of resentment. Why do we have to follow and obey? The years of anger, the years of insecurity, the burdens of obedience that were so heavy in our lives. Oh Lord, we were at home already, but we behaved like slaves. For many of us, you did not only call us to be young children, but you called us to take responsibility in your household. We were older brothers, older sisters. Yes, O Lord, we did our duty, but all the years of doing and caring and working, thinking like slaves, we did not find much joy in working for you. We only worked when there were benefits. When there were no benefits and privileges, when there was no recognition and applause, we just plowed along, just giving the minimum. After all, we need to act and behave as older brothers in your household. Oh Lord, please forgive us. And today, we ask that through your Holy Spirit, may our hearts overflow with love and gratitude, so that every moment of our life will be a life of freedom. Now we are free to really follow you and obey you with all our heart, with all our soul, and with all our being. Now, because we are your children, we can work hard with all the joy and the happiness and the passion that is yours as we work with you in bringing others into your kingdom. And Lord, because you are our Father and because you are in control, we can even experience meaning when we go through the sufferings of life, because you are our Father. O Lord, our Father, in this meeting, we only ask for one blessing, that through your Holy Spirit, the love of your Son who died for us will always be a part of our experience. And that love, that His sacrifice, will motivate us to honor you with holy lives and to serve you and the world with fruitfulness. O God, please take our hearts and our lives, sinful as it may be, because we have none else to offer you. And we know that because you are our Father, you ask for nothing else. So, Lord, here we are. Accept us. And may your grace be more than sufficient for us. Amen.